Hi, Professor Groundlin here. The nutrition course is designed to provide you with knowledge that can be helpful for making decisions about your life, decisions that can impact your health in the future. So far, we have looked into the digestive system, the food sources and functions of the macronutrients and micronutrients, and the dietary recommendations. Now we're going to turn our attention to the energy balance, the effect of body composition on health outcomes, and in an upcoming chapter, the importance of physical activity in energy balance. Let's look at the calorie expenditure side of the equation. How do we spend our energy? Our total daily energy expenditure falls into three categories. The majority of the energy is used for basic life processes such as making new cells, communication between neurons, making hormones, etc. These expenditures fall into a category called basal metabolism, and factors such as your gender, your age, lean body mass, and your genetic profile can influence how many calories that takes. The other categories are the thermal effect of food. Basically, that's the calories needed for your digestive processes, and physical activity. Physical activity is the most variable. Picture a couch potato versus someone preparing for a triathlon, and you'll get the idea. The calories expended can be determined for an individual in a laboratory, but it's much more convenient to simply make an approximation using the estimated energy requirement calculation. That's that EER that we've already done during this course. In general, when your body calorie intake equals your daily energy expenditures, you'll maintain your body weight. But when your calorie intake is greater than your calorie expenditure, you'll gain weight. And when your calorie intake is lower than your calorie expenditures, you'll lose weight. Maintaining a healthy weight is the goal. A healthy weight lowers the risk of diet-related chronic diseases and gives you the endurance, strength, and flexibility to participate in activities you enjoy, whether that's swimming, roller skating, hiking, skiing, playing with your grandkids, or walking the dog. A healthy weight increases your chance of a high-quality life. Being overweight is associated with increased risk of several chronic conditions, including cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes, sleep apnea, osteoarthritis, and several types of cancer. Being underweight is associated with a different set of health outcomes. For instance, increased risk of anemia, amenorrhea, depressed immune system functions, and osteoporosis. Although in this course we have focused mainly on physical health, it should be noted that being underweight or overweight have psychological and social impacts too. These may include poor self-esteem and feeling like people have preconceived notions about your personality based on your weight. So how do you know if you're the right weight? There are actually several aspects that are important to consider together. Let's take a look at a few of these. First, let's look at body fat. Our adipose tissue serves several required functions in the body, such as cushioning, insulation, and energy storage. Adipose tissue is highly vascular, and it's made up primarily of adipocytes, or fat cells. Your adipocytes are designed as variable-sized storage closets. During a positive energy balance, that is, you're taking in more calories than you're using, triglycerides are stored and the fat cells expand in size. During a negative energy balance, the fat cells shrink as triglycerides are removed for the body's cells to use for energy production. The number of fat cells doesn't really change. It's the size of the closet that changes. For health considerations, how much body fat we have and where it's located both matter. For good health, men should have 10 to 20% body fat and women should have 16 to 26% body fat. A body composition assessment can help us determine the percent of our weight that's fat tissue versus the percent that's lean tissue. There are many methods described in your book for making those assessments, including hydrostatic weighing, skinfold tests, the DEXA, and bioelectrical impedance. The percent is important, but you also need to know where it's located, because abdominal, visceral, and subcutaneous fat is associated with increased risk of hypertension, diabetes, and heart disease. Subcutaneous fat around the buttocks and thighs does not carry those same health effects. A waist circumference measure can help you determine if you have excess abdominal fat. Body mass index, or BMI, is the weight to height calculation and can be useful for making quick assessments for an individual. It is one aspect to be considered along with other factors. A high or low BMI may indicate that you are at risk for health problems associated with being overweight or underweight. Taken together, the percent body fat, body shape, and BMI can be useful as a part of a health assessment to determine if you have risk for chronic diseases associated specifically with body weight. And if you add those factors to your family history of problems such as hypertension, type 2 diabetes, and elevated cholesterol levels, and your information about your normal eating patterns, for example, are you constantly getting too much saturated or trans fats, too much sugar, not getting enough calcium? You can get a pretty good assessment of your general risk for diet-associated chronic health issues. Suppose that you look at those risks and decide you want to make some adjustments to help lower those risks. If your diet analysis showed patterns of deficiencies or excesses, make those little adjustments to balance out those nutrients. If your family history has cardiovascular disease, limit those saturated fats and cholesterol. Increase those omega-3s. Start making small adjustments and then make them into a regular eating pattern. If your body fat, BMI, and waist circumference indicated an increased risk, try some of the techniques suggested in the textbook. If those numbers were a bit too high, you're going to need to cut calories. There's lots of ways to do that, but it does require thinking about what you're eating and being more intentional about your food intake. You can substitute low-calorie foods in place of high-calorie foods, or you can eat smaller portions at meals, or you can cut out a snack or alcohol. Set a goal of losing a half a pound to a pound a week. At that rate, you'll still get all the nutrients you need, and you should not feel starved or deprived of food and end up binging. Let's face it, when we binge, it's usually not on low-calorie nutritious foods. Remember that food plate from earlier this semester? Half of the plate was fruits and veggies. Now that we've looked into the importance of fiber in your diet, looked at good food sources for the vitamins and minerals, and what can happen when you're deficient in those vitamins and minerals, you can see the importance of those fruits and veggies. Related to weight, those are relatively low calorie, and with their fiber and their high water content, they can make you feel full so that you eat less of the high calorie foods. That feeling of being full is called satiety, and it triggers our nervous system and the endocrine system to decrease the feeling that you're hungry and you'll stop eating. Protein and healthy fats can also increase satiety. So, meals with a lean source of protein, whole grains, fruits, and veggies are sensible for weight loss. On the opposite side of that balance is the energy used, and increasing your physical activity helps use more calories. But it also creates lean body mass, which in turn increases your basal metabolism. That's a win-win situation. If the percent of the body fat and BMI are too low, you're going to need to add calories. People think that that's easy, but if they talk to someone who feels full very quickly and is very uncomfortable when they feel full, they'd realize that it's not easy for some people to gain weight. People who need to gain weight will need to add calories every day. This can be done by selecting higher calorie but nutrient-dense foods, slowly increasing their portion sizes, or adding small snacks throughout the day. It's important to get physical exercise because you're going to want it to be lean body mass and not just extra adipose tissue. Whether you're trying to gain or lose weight, the key is to make small changes at a time and then to let those good food choices develop into healthy eating patterns. I hope you really enjoy the information in these chapters about energy balance. And as always, contact me if you have questions.